While most dietary supplements are, generally speaking, a waste of money, there are a few supplements that appear to be worth taking. Creatine happens to be one of those supplements. Creatine was first discovered in 1832 when it was extracted by French scientist Michel Eugène Chevreul from a liquefied sample of skeletal muscle. Chevreul would name this new compound after the Greek word for meat, kreos. It was only in 1912, however, that researchers at Harvard University realized that consuming large quantities of creatine did not affect how fast the creatine was removed from the body. Instead, this extra dietary creatine was stored inside the body in skeletal muscle. Today we have an abundance of studies that demonstrate creatine's effectiveness at improving exercise performance by increasing muscle mass and strength and decreasing the time needed for recovery. But creatine isn't only found in muscles. Creatine is also stored in significant quantities in the brain. Many scientists now believe that creatine supplementation can do wonders for the brain, most notably due to its powerful antidepressant properties. My name is Hashim and I'm a medical doctor, and this is my YouTube channel where I make videos that explain how the brain works and why it sometimes doesn't. If that's the kind of stuff you want to watch here on YouTube, then you should subscribe and hit the bell icon so you're notified when I upload my next video next week. The human brain weighs only 2% of total body mass. Despite this, however, the brain is a metabolically demanding organ that consumes 20% of total energy produced by the body at rest. To meet these high energy demands, brain cells will use glucose and ketone bodies to produce ATP, adenosine triphosphate, which can be used as a currency for energy inside the cell. ATP, however, is pretty unstable. Creatine, on the other hand, isn't. Creatine is best described as an energy buffer. Once inside the cell, it's readily converted into phosphocreatine, allowing energy to be stored inside the cell in a more stable form than ATP. That's also easier to transport around the cell. This is crucial because it means that cells with high creatine levels will always have access to energy, in the form of ATP to be used by the cell right now, and in the form of phosphocreatine to be used by the cell in the next 5 seconds or so. In other words, cells with high creatine are unlikely to face an energy liquidity crisis. Creatine therefore promotes healthy cellular metabolism in both muscles and the brain. Depression has traditionally been simplified and reduced into a condition caused by a chemical imbalance or a serotonin deficiency. But there is evidence out there to suggest that impaired brain metabolism could also play a significant role in the pathogenesis of depression. For example, we know that people with metabolic disease are more likely to be diagnosed with depression. In fact, depression is 3 times more common in people with type 1 diabetes and 2 times more common in type 2 diabetics. We now think that poor cellular metabolism might compromise a brain cell's access to energy reserves, which might make it more vulnerable to internal and external stress events, leading to depression. Creatine can help prevent this. Multiple studies have illustrated that patients with major depression frequently have low creatine levels in key areas of the brain, including the prefrontal cortex, cingulate cortex, and the left hippocampus. Some studies have even gone further and supplemented severely depressed patients with 4 to 8 grams of creatine per day for a period of 8 weeks. The results? Creatine was able to decrease the severity of depression in a group of adult women by around 60%. These women were all women who had not responded to traditional antidepressant medication, including SSRIs and SNRIs. The results were so encouraging, in fact, that another research team performed an experiment to measure the effects of creatine in combination with an SSRI, fluoxetine, also known as Prozac. In this study, fluoxetine and creatine together were significantly more effective at improving depression symptoms than fluoxetine alone. In one study, however, creatine did not significantly improve depression symptoms in a group of 18 patients. I find this interesting because this experiment had a much shorter duration of only 4 weeks compared to 8 weeks in the other studies. This could potentially mean that creatine supplementation requires a minimum of 6 to 8 weeks before it's able to improve depression symptoms. Which could actually make sense, as creatine taken by mouth would likely distribute all over the body during the first few weeks of treatment, rather than be specifically taken up by the brain. The research agrees that taking 4 to 6 grams of creatine per day for a minimum period of 6 to 8 weeks can improve depression symptoms. Furthermore, creatine has been demonstrated to be safe at daily doses of up to 10 grams taken for up to 5 years. Moreover, very few participants in any of the studies mentioned in this video experienced any adverse side effects. And while an old case study did suggest that creatine might worsen kidney function, many studies have since established that creatine doesn't affect kidney function whatsoever. In one experiment, participants received 20 grams of creatine per day for 7 days before being sleep deprived for 36 hours. The participants who took creatine achieved significantly better scores on cognitive tests than the placebo group, implying that creatine may protect against the effects of sleep deprivation. Which makes me think that if nothing else, creatine can offer my brain an energy buffer, protecting it from its very worst enemy. Seriously though, cellular metabolism is no joke, and it should definitely be something you think about. If you enjoyed this video, then please give this video a like and subscribe if you have not done so already. New videos for a better brain every week.